everybody keeps saying they're comparing it to the Tiger King, and it was so funny. My mom was like, why do they keep comparing us to the Tiger King? And I'm like, well, on the one hand, okay, that's not a good thing. I'm like, those guys are insane, but it's a good thing if you want, you know, it means it'll be popular.
You must go into it with a vision for what the documentary will end up being. And in your case, it's really unique because it's your family story, so you know a lot of it. But what was the documentary that you had in your head?
Well, the plan was to not really be about my family. It was going to be all about the stores and how amazing they were as part of gay history. And I didn't want to be a part of the story, and I didn't really want my family that exposed either. I was hoping just to try to find a collaborator that could just help me in almost as clinical a way as possible to just get the story of the importance of gay porn and these two stores to the history of gay culture, as it's still an unwritten history. And I didn't expect it to twist and turn as much into the kind of revealing, in-depth expose on my family and my mother and my relationship with her in the store.
So how did you approach, I guess, this being about your family, but also knowing that you needed to make a documentary and therefore there are certain filmmaker kind of rules almost that you need to abide by?
Right off the bat, I had a really great producer basically co-directing it early on with me, and this was Cynthia Childs, just gave me the perspective that I needed early on to say, okay, you know, do this and do that and don't do this and do that, but we'll film it all and we'll see what we get. And that's how I started. And then it was really in the editing room, you know, after looking at all the footage, that I had an amazing editor, Catherine Robson, and we worked in the other side of things hand in hand, where, you know, like I was like, shit, I can't believe I was crying in that scene. Let's cut that. And Catherine's like, no, let's keep that. That's actually really good. And I'm, you know, like, well, that's not something I'm very proud of, you know. And so you have to sort of balance your ego. You have to balance your set of expectations of what you want to accomplish. There were things that only I could capture if nobody else but me was doing it. And even like talking to Larry Flint, you know, he really wanted to sit down and talk to me and tell me what my parents did to him as the first distributors. So, you know, here I am in front of like God of pornography, Larry Flint, and he's telling me that your parents were the center of my operation at the very beginning. You know, he granted the interview because I'm the daughter of the owners. And that was this type of access that I started to recognize I had. And it also gave me insight into how deep their involvement was with all these different people. And the same thing with Jeff Stryker. You know, he's a very private guy. My parents had a hand in like all of these iconic, seminal, you know, important successes. Just the other day, you know, I did a photo shoot at the Tom of Finland house. My dad just casually was like looking at this picture and he goes, oh yeah, well, we met Tom. He came into the store and we set him up for some book signings. In some ways, I had a front row seat to this very specific aspect of gay history without recognizing or knowing it.
When you were meeting these people, like who were they to you? Like, what did you think at the time that these colleagues or whatever of your parents were?
Well, the store was so filled with the most fabulous people. I mean, just look at Alaska, you know, the clerks at the store. Alaska was a clerk. And imagine I was a kid and they had so many fantastic, fabulous, young, beautiful, charming, entertaining clerks that were all in various stages of showbiz and their careers were about to take off, many of them. And, you know, I would meet these guys and I, you know, as a young fag hag, I was obsessed and I loved them. And I just thought they were amazing. And then my mom would just, you know, they wouldn't be there the next week or so. And then she would say, well, oh yeah, well, you know, Bill, he died, or John died, or Lee, he died. And it was very matter of fact, because when you are dealing with that much death, you end up having to just say that. And I think as a kid, I didn't know that I was in the center of an epidemic, that my parents were at the center of an epidemic. It's hard to believe, but when I look back on it now, I just thought, wow, I had a child's perspective on the AIDS epidemic. And I got to see and know these really beautiful guys. And to me, they were grown-ups and they were, you know, interesting. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But now, as somebody who's, you know, 41, I'm like, wow, those guys were kids. They were in their 20s. They were even younger than that. They were so young.
I suppose it's why documentaries like yours, though, are so important, because, like, you're not born into a community in the way that most communities are built. So you have to learn about the history.
Yeah, and I really love also the fact that this gives a glimpse into the more edgy, the dark side, the freaky element of gay culture that really was out there and sexual. And because that was actually what was amazing about gay culture, you know, Vaseline Alley.
Yeah, I mean, that.
it was wild.
You could walk back to the back room and there was some steps to the attic. And I had sex in the attic.
And then at the same time, you have your parents who, at least for me, they come across as really pragmatic about it.
They are very matter of fact. They're not a very emotional people. I will say that if you watch those scenes very closely during the AIDS era, my parents are both on the edge of tears. It was not an easy time. And I think actually to receive phone calls like the kind my mom got from relatives and parents who were truly not there for their kids when they needed them most. I mean, it was so shocking. And I think you can hear that my mom is so angry with them, just as like from one mother to another, but especially as one religious parent to another.
It was a horrible, horrible
time. Despite the pragmatism sometimes when it comes to kind of the business and being involved in this social movement, in the end, they end up in a huge queer organization.
Yeah, no, and I think actually what they do now is really their activism is constant. They are constantly, you know, working to do what they can to expand and help PFLAG. And, you know, I can't go over to their house on a Wednesday because they have PFLAG meetings, and it's absolutely the most vital, important thing, you know. And my mom is right out there marching and telling me to put my camera away because she has a job to do at PFLAG. You know, she takes it very seriously. And you're like, wow, these kids are incredible, wonderful people. Why can't you appreciate them? Oh, because they're queer? Okay, well, that's not a reason. Let's fix that. You know, they are really pragmatic. And I think that's one of those things that my dad at some point said about being gay. It's like they used to make lefties tie their left hand behind their back and try to write with the right hand. And then they would eventually just be not good right-handed people. They couldn't write well. And so that's the same thing that we do with gay people.
Was there a hesitancy for you in terms of bringing them in and putting the spotlight on people who are not, as far as I know anyway, not interested in being in the spotlight?
You know, I talked to my family about it and they all were like, well, okay, as long as nobody really sees this thing, I guess we'll participate.
Sorry.
No, yeah, like, oops, I guess we're getting a global Netflix deal. But no, you know, they were, of course, really delighted that it is doing well and it's serving the greater good. But, you know, I actually have a very private family who are not public. If anyone, the irony is that I'm the public one in my family and I have played the smallest role in this film.
It's just so weird to me that you wouldn't have thought that I would have cared, right? I mean, I didn't care. I wouldn't. I mean, my world was gay anyway. Like, why wouldn't you have wanted to jump into my world?
Your world was too gay.
Going back to your brother, one of your brothers very briefly, like, he's very vulnerable in it and talking about really personal things. Did you, as you were building the documentary, did you realize how important his story was, his particular story was, to the overall story of your parents and where they went through this journey?
You know, of course you don't see these things when you're living your life and just doing your thing. And I only ever felt really sad that he had to endure anything like that. And it was very painful for me. And I didn't actually want to probe him like that. And yet I think he and I both had an awareness at some point that his story was the one that would really be the most impactful for the most number of people that were like him. There's way more people that relate to a normal guy like Josh struggling with just figuring out how he's going to tell his parents than they do to someone like me, who is, you know, a wild child artist.
Yeah. There's also something very relatable, I think, in we see stories of kids being rejected from with parents of very extreme views, or being completely accepted by people. But actually, it's something quite relatable in somebody coming out to parents who you would guess would be pretty fine, actually having a hard time coming to terms with that and having to work through that together. Like, that's not something you see a lot, but it's probably a reality for a lot of people.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, what was interesting to me was that my brother had ever even thought that he would have to get a one-way ticket and not be allowed to come back. And that's what led me to start crying in an interview. And I felt a sense of shame that I, as a teenager, was so caught up in my radical, weirdo, queer group of friends that I had no time to even look down and notice Josh struggling and coming out of the closet and being queer himself. And I mean, I love my brother to death. We were like, you know, basically like best friends growing up. And then I left and I went to college, and I wasn't there for him when he was struggling so much. And to look back at that moment, the reason I just had so much sorrow was that he was so in so much pain. So the fact that we got to make this film and have that interview allowed us to have that conversation.
I'd love to know what your family think of the film now that it's done and in the world.
Well, my mom says it's a good film, but she wishes it was about anyone except herself. And I think they really all, my mom, you know, hoped that no one would ever see it.
She seems so, like, constantly saying, like, you don't want to film this, it's not interesting. Like, I find that fascinating, because I think her life is one of the most interesting lives I've ever heard of. And then that piece where she says, I can't quote it exactly, but when she says, like, parents are only wise for a small amount of time.
Parents are only smart for a very small window of time.
Your parents seem so wise.
Yeah, no, that was a great line. And I, you know, I was a little surprised to hear all those things, because often with me, I'm on the receiving end of all of her criticism and nothing is ever good enough. And
yeah.
So then I hear these things where I'm like, wow, you have the ability to be humble and step back and admit that you're completely wrong. And I think it's very relatable to a lot of other people that were raised with this, you know, this kind of like burned in religion. It's very deep, and it almost is like a reflex when you are, you know, being brought out into this thing where it doesn't relate. So I'm just going to say this, you know, God must have been punishing me. And it sounds so like biblical, Old Testament, crazy, you know, God with a staff on a stick, burning bush. And I'm like, what? How did those words come out of the mouth of the world's biggest porn distributor?
I've spent the last 20 years helping other people understand and accept the gender variations in their children. And there are a lot of gender variations. And they're all okay. And I hope you put that in this movie.
The funniest thing that I like in the press is when people are like, well, Netflix came up with the craziest idea yet. Yeah. So it was like Netflix's grand vision or Netflix and Ryan Murphy made this idea. And I'm like, wow, it's so funny. That's actually my life that they're talking about.
And your family and your life.
Masterminded by the people at Netflix.
Yes.
The powers that
we are incredibly powerful. Great. Well, thank you so much for your time, Rachel. I really appreciate
it. Of course. Thank you. And have a great rest of your day. I hope you got everything.